bit earlier than usual, so I know you might not be accustomed to this. Give you a few moments. We ask if you're able to kneel as we begin our worship service. Amen. We ask if you're able, if you can stand and join us in singing our call to worship. The glory of the Lord is in this place.
Father and our God, once again, we are grateful to you for your blessings. Thank you, Lord, for bringing us here today to worship you. And as we do, Father, we pray for your Holy Spirit to be here with us. Bless everyone who is here. Bless those who are watching via the internet. We thank you and praise you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Welcome again, everyone. We'll have a special time where we'll greet each other after this first song. But our first song is Draw Me Nearer. If you prefer to follow along in your hymns, it's hymn 306, Draw Me Nearer, Lord, to Thee.
Thank you.
singing our family song. This is a time when we greet each other and welcome each other. We talk for a few moments, and then we'll reassemble and come back to our seats. Again, welcome and happy Sabbath. This is a time when we start to meditate and reflect on just how great God is. He's the great I am. We want to introduce you to a new song this morning by Phillips Craig and Dean entitled, The Great I Am.
Ah!
may be seated.
Happy Sabbath, church. Happy Sabbath. Okay. It's time to welcome our guests to our church. We welcome everybody to the Sabbath day today. We want to welcome those people who are on the internet also. Please, when you hear me, your name call, just raise up your hand. We would like to put something in your hands. And the first name is Antonio and Elizabeth Yucedo. They're from Hispanic Church. Thank you for coming. Keep your hands up, so something is coming your way. The second person is Jamie Tolosa, and is from Cherrydale Baptist Church. Keep your hands up. We're glad you're with us. Please come again. We also have Joy Allen. Joy Allen, where are you? Okay, keep your hands up. Something is coming your way. Oh, you got it already. Good. Please visit us again. We also have Michael, Sheila, Anthony, and I'm sorry if I miscall your name. Washington. Oh, here we go. This lovely couple. Keep your hands up. Something is coming your way. And they're from Mary Washington. Quantico, thank you. Yeah, Quantico, thank you. Please come again. And I have from our community right here, we have Paul Krumet, Louisa Hancock. Oh, keep your hands up. Say hello to them. Okay. Now, those guests that have been attending our Daniel seminar, if you can raise your hands up, if you are with us today. Anybody that has been attending, yes, we have something coming your way. Thank you for attending. And people on the internet, you are welcome also. And please do not forget, after the church, there's a potluck right on my right side, your left side. We're going to come together and have a good food. Don't miss it. Thank you.
Thank you, Larry. Thank you for being here today. Just a couple of things that I'd like to point out to. The first thing is, he mentioned it, and that is we have a fellowship meal, and everyone is welcome to join us. Today we have the first reading for a couple of people. We have David and Daniela Muñoz from Iglesia Adventista in Jarabacoa and Dominican Republic to our church. And next week we'll have the second reading for these two young people. We also have from our church to the Community Praise Church in Alexandria, Virginia, Cassandra Jones, and next week we'll do the second reading for her. I'd like to remind you and invite you to come out to prayer meeting, and that is every Wednesday at 7 p.m. I'd like to point out that we're studying the miracles of Jesus. Come out and receive a blessing. And while we're on prayer, like to remind you to pray for each of these individuals that are on the screen and families that they have needs. And we also would like to remind you of a couple of things that are coming up. One is we have the school board meeting at 6:30 p.m. this coming Monday. And next Sabbath, we will have Children's Sabbath. And then there is a picnic after the service. Now, on the 28th, which is the following Sabbath, we are going to have our family life weekend. And so we'd like to invite you to come out for that. We have a special guest who is going to talk to us about family life and how you can have a better family. And also in November, we have our International Sabbath, and it's going to be a special Sabbath. And I'd like to invite you to make plans to be here for that. Now, we have a special Sabbath today, and that is we are going to have a baptism. And I'd like to invite our candidates to come up at this time. Okay. Praise the Lord. God bless you. Okay. All right. So, you want to look that way? Yeah. There we go. We're so happy that Beth and Rodney have decided to follow Jesus Christ. Amen. This is what it's all about, bringing people to know Jesus Christ. And we're happy that Rodney and Beth have decided to do that. And we have gone through the baptismal vows with them individually. And so at this time, what I'd like to ask if there is a motion to accept them into our church. Is there a second? All those in favor? Amen. So at this time, what we would like to do is continue with the service, and we will go downstairs and change. While we are changing, you are going with the program. Thank you.
It's time for the Lamb offering. This is the time when the young people go for their basket and they come to collect some of the funds to help out the school. Please make sure you dig deep and give to those little ones. Okay, little ones, make sure you go through the aisles. Don't just come straight up, okay? And we have the children's story reading. It's for by Ilsa Camacho. So. Children, come on. Go and get your bucket. Okay.
I see children that remain seated. I know your names. Come. I'm missing you all. Come. Mr. A. He's ignoring me. I know that. Said Gian and Christian. Thank you for your help. Oh, one more? Oh, okay. Caleb, we're waiting for you. In the meantime, I'm going to start my story. Good morning. Happy Sabbath. Are there any children here? Let me try that again. Good morning.
Happy Sabbath. Yes. This week, I had a very short trip to the pond. See, I have a son who is in high school, and he is taking a class called biology. Have you heard that, of that subject, the study of life? Well, he had an assignment, which was to collect water from a pond, because later on, we wanted to look in under the microscope for tiny, tiny creatures. We haven't done that part yet, but we did go to the pond to collect some water. Have you been to the pond? Have you been to the pond? Have you ever gone to a pond? Yes, you have. Is it kind of like fun or boring? It's fun. Wherever there's water and rocks, right? That's fun. Well, we went there, and the very first thing we did was got like near the shore, and we looked in the water. Does that water look crystal clear and clean, or does it look murky and greenish and dark? How does the pond water look to you? Is it clear, like water that is clear that is inviting you to go in the water? Not really. We were able to see fish. Tiny fish were coming to us. I think they were thinking that we were going to feed them. That's what I thought. Lots of fish came to the shore, to the very edge. And I was like, wow. And I was really enjoying it. The pond is full of life. Today, I want to show you quickly about some of the living creatures that we might find in the pond. We did not get to see blue herons, but they look just like that. I do remember there's another place further north in Prince William where we have visited, like, and we have done some canoeing, and we have seen these. But not all ponds have the same living creatures. However, they like to stand still in the water, and they come to the pond and look for what? Food, yes, for fish. That's exactly what they're looking for. They come to look for fish. That's their dinner. Other creatures that we might find at the pond might not be as large. Some of them are so tiny that even be microscopic. There is a little one-cell creature called amoeba. Have you heard of that word? As I was looking for pictures to show you, I found this neat picture. I was like, wow. I've never seen a picture of an amoeba eating. Do you know what that is? That is eating? It is not plankton, but that's a good guess. What is it? That's not fish. It looks like fish. Keep in mind, this is so tiny that can only be seen under the microscope. That is a paramecium. And it's another one-cell creature that lives in the water. It's so tiny, we cannot see it. But I thought that picture was just so cool. I bet the next creature I'm going to show you have seen. Water striders. Have you seen them? All the time. Have you caught one before? They are difficult to catch. Yes, especially because you would need to go in the water to get them. Isn't it cool? It seems like they can walk on water. Can we walk on water? No, we can't. How is it that it's possible for them to walk on water? Yes, they're very light. They have long, thin legs. And at the end of those legs, they have large, flat feet. And you know what? Those feet have tiny, tiny, like hair-like parts that, just like the bird's feathers, it's like waxy. They have like a wax, so it does not allow water to go through those hairs, and it helps them to kind of float. There's another creature that I bet you have seen at the creek or the pond, and those are crayfish. Can we see that picture? Can we skip? There. Have you ever gotten one of those crayfish? Yes, yes. Some of them are really, really tiny. That's kind of like on the larger side. They look like a mini, mini lobster, right? They help clean up the bottom of the pond, actually. And there's also another animal that helps clean up the bottom of the pond, which is the catfish. There it is. Now, keep in mind, not all ponds have the same creatures. How about the salamander? That's not one of my favorite creatures. It is slimy, they're fast, but they need water because when they are babies, they hatch from eggs that have been laid in the water. Later on, as they become adults, they go out and live on the land. However, well, I guess I'm going ahead in my story, but when they are going to lay eggs again, they go back to the pond where they were hatched. Let me show you one more creature. That is the fire red water mite. I've never heard of that one before. Those are really, really tiny, and those animals live among the pond plants. If you put 10 of those together, you could feel like an inch on the ruler. Why am I talking about all these animals? They actually, before I move on, those mites, they like to like take it like a hitch on other animals, and they suck their living, like the juices from inside, and that's how they live. They attach to living animals, and they just, like mosquitoes, suck the life out of them. Ducks. Have you seen ducks by the pond? Yes. Ducks love to be by the pond. Do you know how to make a difference between the female and the male duck? Do you know what the difference is? What is it? Well, yes, the colors of their feathers. Is that what you're going to say? The male duck, the feathers are bright, very colorful. The female, the mommy, the mom duck, does not have so many bright colors. God made it like that so she could hide easily from predators, and the predators would not get their chicks. Plants, next. Plants are extremely important in the pond. They help to provide hiding places for creatures. They also help provide food. There's a tiny, tiny, tiny plant, next, called plankton. It is so small that a single drop of water contains thousands of them, but they are the source of food for many other creatures, like the water flea, next. Did you know there's a water flea? They are so tiny, and they're transparent, and you can see their insides. That yellow thing is its heart, and it pumps colorless blood. I learned so much putting together this story for you guys. Why am I talking about all these creatures? I think I'm done. Is that the end of the slides? Yes. All of these creatures in the pond need each other. Scientists love to study the creatures in the pond. They love to study what eat what. Who needs what for living? The dogs need the plants to hide and lay their eggs. The flea needs the plankton to eat. The salamander needs to smell the algae and the plants, so it goes back to the place where it was hatched so she can lay more eggs, so more salamanders are made, or so there's more salamanders. We are, our church, our family, our church family is kind of like that pond where we are all an important part. We all need each other to live and to survive, especially because we're working together to make it to heaven, aren't we? So God asks us to encourage each other, to help each other. If you see a visitor, someone who you have not seen before, it would be so awesome to say, "Hi, happy Sabbath. Welcome. It's so great to have you with us. I want to encourage you to help each other in church. If you have friends in your Sabbath school class, let's be friendly. Let's be nice. Let's be kind. Let's be loving. Let's help and encourage each other. If you see someone who is sad or is down, what can we do? What can we do, Sophia? We can help them feel better by what? You can just probably just put together a card or pray for them, right? God asks us to work for each other so we are a happy family and we can make it together to heaven with him. Can we do that? Let's have a word of prayer. Let's have a word of prayer and then I give it to you. Who would like to pray? Someone that I have. Would you like to pray? No? Would you like to pray? You raise your hand. No? Come. Oh. Well, we can have two small prayers. Come. Ouch. Are you okay?
Yes.
Okay. Let's pray. Dear God. Dear God.
Dear God.
Thank you.
Thank you.
For our family.
For? Don't stop me.
Family in church.
In church.
Help us.
Help us.
To be nice.
Be nice.
To each other.
Each other.
In Jesus' name.
Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
One more. You're good? Okay, we're good. God bless you all.
Baptismal candidate, his name is Rodney Davis. His favorite scripture is found in Psalm 23, 1 to 3. It reads thus, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake." And his favorite song is hymn number 633, "When We All Get to Heaven."
God is pleased with your decision to follow Jesus Christ. The Bible says that there is joy in heaven over one sinner that repents. And today, you begin your walk with Him, with God. And so, today, as a minister of the gospel, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
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 Our second baptismal candidate is Beth Wright. Her favorite scripture is found in Psalm 24, verse 5 and 6. He shall receive blessing from the Lord and righteousness from the God of his salvation. This is Jacob, the generation of those who seek him, who seek your face, Selah. And her favorite song is hymn number 108, Amazing Grace.
Take special notice of this day, because this day you say, I want to follow Jesus Christ. I leave all my sins behind, and I trust in his power to forgive me. Amen. And so today, Beth, you decide to follow Jesus Christ. Today you say, I want to give my life to him. And so as a minister of the gospel, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. What a wonderful day to come and witness people giving their life to Jesus Christ. The angels of God are here. The Holy Spirit is here. And what we know is that in every gathering there are people who have never decided to follow Jesus Christ. But you witness this today because God wanted you to be here today. And so, as it is our custom at every baptism, I have to make the invitation. If there is anyone here that says, I want to prepare for the next baptism. I too want to give my life to Jesus Christ. I too want to take that step of baptism. If that is your desire, I'd like for you to raise your hand right there where you are. Anyone that says, I want to follow Jesus Christ. I want to prepare for the next baptism. Praise God, I see a hand back there. Anyone else? Anyone else? I want us to bow our heads as we pray today. Father in heaven, the angels of God are rejoicing right now because not only one person has decided to follow Jesus Christ, but two people. Today they seal their destiny through baptism. But Father, there are people this morning here who haven't taken that step. And I saw a young person back there raising their hand, signifying that they too want to take that step. And so Father, I pray in a special way for that person that raised their hand. Bless that person, Lord, in a mighty way. Seal that decision, Lord, today. May this be the beginning of some great things in his life. But Father, there may be others. And as your heads are bowed and your eyes are closed, if you too want to say, I want to prepare to meet Jesus. I want to see him in peace. I want to give my life to him through baptism. One more time. If there is anyone, praise God. Praise God. Praise God. We're going to ask Tracy and Larry to come up at this time. And also the young man who put his hand up. I want to have a special prayer for you. Come on up. Come right here. Praise God for you, Tracy. And Larry, God bless you. I would say, God bless you. Okay? And what is your name, young man? AJ? Okay, God bless you. Let's bow our heads. Father, thank you for your Holy Spirit that continues to work in our hearts, continues to call us to follow you. We pray a special blessing upon AJ, Larry, and Tracy. Father, you know them. You died for them. We pray in a special way for them, Lord, right now. May your Holy Spirit fill their hearts. May the blessings of heaven be upon them and their families. Thank you, Lord, in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Amen. If you don't mind, if you could sit in the front pew for just a couple of seconds, we have one of our elders who is going to take your name. All right? God bless you. We will continue with our program. Amen.
Time for worship and giving, and I'm going to call on our head elder, Brother James, to give you the worship and giving.
Good morning, happy Sabbath. I'd like to read to you a particular text in Mark, the 12th chapter, beginning at verse 41. And Jesus sat over against the treasury and beheld how the people cast money into the treasury, and many that were rich cast in much. And there came a certain poor widow, and she threw in two mites, which makes a farthing. And she called unto him his disciples, and saith unto them, Verily I say unto you, that this poor widow hath cast more in than all they which have cast into the treasury. For they all did cast in of their abundance, but she of her want did cast in all that she had, even all her living. I don't know today what's in your wallet or your bank account, nor do I need to know. But I pray that the spirit that attended this woman on that day, which was God's spirit, that moved her to give out of what she had, will impress us today to do the same. I would ask the deacons to rise at this time. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we are thankful for what we've witnessed here today. Two commitments were sealed, and there was joy in heaven. Father, there's joy here in your house. We pray that we would give out of what we have, Lord, that we would be moved to do over and above what the expectation is, and that we will give out of a love relationship that will continue to be facilitated and ushered in when you come back to this earth. May these funds be used for the advancement of your kingdom. And may they be used also to encourage our hearts to partner with you even in greater ways. This we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Baptism is such a great thing. And to see people give their lives to Christ is just amazing. So please listen to the words of this song, I Give Myself Away.
Give myself away so you can use me. I give myself away. I give myself away so you can use me. Here I am. Here I stand.
Wonderful song. All right. Please allow me to read from the Spirit of Prophecy, opening the heart to God. Prayer is the opening of the heart to God as to a friend. Not that it is necessary in order to make God known to God, in order to make known to God, what we are, but in order to enable us to receive him. Prayer does not bring God down to us, but bring us to him. This is found in Steps to Christ, page 93. So it's time for guiding of prayer. And I just pray that if you have anything, you want to give praises, you have any requests, and if you are so willing, you can come to the front. And those who cannot, please bow down and kneel. Let's give God praise. Let's come and pray.
He is Lord.
Heavenly Father, omnipotent God, we thank you for this day. We thank you for a blessed Sabbath that we can lay everything behind, and for the day that you have blessed and set apart, that we could come and worship you. We thank you for seeing us throughout the week. Oh Lord God, may the blessing of today be on every one of us here. And those people worshiping us from the internet. Right now, Lord, we pray for everybody that has come to the front and all those people who are kneeling in the church congregation. Our needs are different. Our wants are different. But we all want one thing. We need you. And we just pray that you forgive us all our sins. We pray that you continue to send your Holy Spirit to lead us. Lord, whatever the need might be, you know. You said before we even call, you will answer. And we don't even know how to pray sometimes, but when we do pray, the Holy Spirit mingles it up and brings it up to you. Father, we thank you for all the seminar that we've been going through, and it's going to be coming to an end today. We pray that everything that we've been learning, that the Holy Spirit will stay in our heart and stay in that soil, and that the enemy will not take it away. And then we shall be of blessing to others. And we claim this promise and we thank you, because replete throughout Daniel is where we see that judgment is for the saints. And soon you're going to come back to this world, and that stone is going to fill the whole mountain. We pray that everyone here, oh Lord, none, our families, our friends, will be missing on that day. Father, we remember everybody that is sick. We pray that you send your holy hand and your Holy Spirit, touch them wherever issues that they might be having. We pray that you be with this church, be with the young, the old, the men, and the young, that you continue to strengthen us and increase our faith. Now we've studied, we've enjoyed Daniel. Now there's work for us to do. We pray that you will equip everybody in this church to be able to be a witness for you. And may everything that we do, we give glory to you. And now today, we thank you also, Father, for those people who you have just baptized. We pray that you continue to be with them as they continue to grow. Now we know that the enemy will come after them. We just pray that you continue to hold them. Father, we pray for the pastor as he's going to break the bread. You keep him behind the veil. Send your Holy Spirit. And we just pray that today, and all the visitors and everybody worshiping with us, that today will be a day of blessing. Father, help each one of us here. Continue to bless us. Answer our prayer. Bless us as you see us throughout the week. and bring us back here on the Sabbath. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. At this time, there's a special music which is going to be given by the Ohana group. Yeah, I was enjoying the music, so. But right now is the scripture reading, and it's going to be given by our sister, Margie Santiago.
Today's scripture reading will be found in Daniel 12:1. At that time, Michael shall stand up, the great prince who stands watch over the sons of your people, and there shall be a time of trouble such as never was since it was a nation, even to that time. And at that time, your people shall be delivered, everyone who is found written in the book. May the Lord bless the reading of his word.
Oh, now is the special time for the song.
Seen the sunset on the day that Jesus died and felt the glow of the sunrise when the tomb was open wide. Would I man.
How's everyone? Very good? Okay. We want to start with a word of prayer. Just ask God to be with us. Father in heaven, today we are grateful to you for your blessing, for allowing us to come and to study your word. We pray now that your Holy Spirit may guide us, may lead us into all truth, Lord. Thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. All right. We are going to do our final presentation of Clarity in Crisis, and that is we are going to look at Daniel chapter 12. Now, how many of you have had the privilege and the opportunity to come to the meetings at least one time? Okay, several of you. All right, God bless you. And, you know, it is amazing how God teaches us through his word. And so right now, what we're going to do is we're going to pass out the lessons. And if you have been coming to the seminar, just raise your hand, and they'll hand you a lesson. So just raise your hand. They'll give you a lesson right away. All right. So last Sunday, we looked at Daniel 11. And I want to tell you, Daniel 11, it is a heavy-duty chapter, if you ask me, because there are so many things there that are presented. And basically, what we want to focus in is the time of the end, and that is Daniel 11, 40 to 45. What we said is that some of these events are still in the future. We don't know the exact details, but we know who holds the future, amen? And that is God. And there is a reason why God tells us these things in advance. And Jesus put it this way in John 14 and verse 29. And now I have told you before it comes, that when it does come to pass, you may what? You may believe. So God tells us in advance what is going to happen so that when we see it happening, we can come to that point of believing. Amen? Believing in God. So as we look at Daniel 11, and as we have looked at the other chapters, sometimes people get lost in the details of prophecy. It is good to know the details of prophecy, but not to the point that you lose your way, because all the details of prophecy point to the great prophecy, and that is the second coming of Jesus Christ. So God asked me to follow him today, trusting him with the personal details of tomorrow. Now, how many of you believe that God is in charge of the future? Amen? How many of you believe that God is in charge of your life, your future? Amen. All right? So Jesus put it this way. He told Paul, he said, my grace is sufficient for you. We need to be filled with God's grace. Amen? With God's grace. And so, you know, it is good to understand the details of prophecy. And as we have looked at Daniel, has 12 chapters. And so today we're going to look at chapter 12, which is the rescue. Now, the grand finale of all prophecies point to the second coming of Jesus Christ. Did you know that in the Bible we have several prophecies that tell us exactly that? I want to read to you, and you can write these down. And that is Revelation 19, verse 11. It says, now I saw heaven open, and behold, a white horse, and he who sat on him was called faithful and true, and in righteousness he judges and makes war. So the question is, who is this rider? Well, we shall see. Describes there in verse 12, his eyes were like what? Like a flame of fire, and on his head were many crowns. He had a name written that no one knew except himself. The following verse says the following. He was clothed with a robe dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of God. Now, there is someone, if you look at John chapter 1, verse 1, he says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. So the Word became flesh in verse 14. So this refers to none other than Jesus Christ himself. And the Bible says in verse 14, and the armies of heaven, clothed in fine linen, white and clean, followed him on white horses. Now that describes the angels of God. Now out of his mouth goes a sharp sword that he should strike the nations, and he himself will rule them with a rod of iron. He himself treads the winepress of the fierceness and wrath of Almighty God. Now, last verse, verse 16. And he has on his robe and on his thigh a name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Aren't you glad that Jesus Christ is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords? Aren't you glad that we can trust him with our future? Amen. And so as we look at the details of prophecy, especially chapter 11, from verses 40 all the way to chapter 12 in verse 4, there is described for us the time of the end. In other words, what is going to happen in the end? And so I want us to open our Bibles, and you can look at it on the screen as well. You can write these down. It says, at that time, Michael shall stand up, the great prince who stands watch over the sons of your people. And then it says, and there shall be a time of trouble, such as never was since there was a nation, even to that time. And at that time, continues in verse 1, your people shall be delivered, everyone who is found written in the book. Now, it describes for us Michael. Question is, who is Michael? We looked at that a few presentations ago. And Michael is a Hebrew word that means one who is like God. And the only one who is like God is Jesus Christ. The only one that identifies fully with God the Father is Jesus Christ. And so we have noted that there is a time prophecy given in the book of Daniel, and that time prophecy ends in 1844. And after that time, it is known as God's judgment hour, or the time of the end. The book of Daniel, Paul says with hope. In other words, it tells us what is going to happen in the end. It tells us that Jesus Christ is coming to this world to rescue us. Amen? The coming of Jesus is everything. How many of you are looking forward to the second coming of Jesus Christ? You know, I was talking to somebody some time ago, and they said, well, I don't want Jesus to come. And I said, why? He said, because I'm not ready. I said, well, he wants us to get ready, amen? He wants us to be ready. And so the book of Daniel points to the second coming of Jesus Christ. It, Paul says with hope, every prophecy in Daniel ends in the coming of Jesus Christ. But just before that happens, God protects his people during the time of trouble. As we noted there in verse 1, is going to be a time of trouble. God will have a people that, when surrounded by catastrophe, will look to Jesus as their Savior. Amen? So once again, Daniel 12:1. It says, at that time, Michael shall stand up, the great prince who stands watch over the sons of your people. So when Michael stands up, when Jesus finishes his work in the sanctuary, he is going to put on his kingly robe, and he's going to make his way down to this planet. Amen? The Bible says in verse 2, and many of those who sleep in the dust of the earth shall awake, some to everlasting life, some to shame and everlasting contempt. So here we have in this verse a description of what is going to happen in the end. It says there's going to be some who are going to be resurrected to everlasting life. And I believe that points to the first resurrection. Did you know that when Jesus comes again, there is going to be a great resurrection? And the graves of the dead are going to open up, and people are going to come up, not as they went into the grave, but they're going to come up in full health, amen? Not with any pain or anything that causes pain. They're going to come up in full health. And so the Bible points to this resurrection, to everlasting life. But then it says some to what? To everlasting contempt. And I believe that points to the second resurrection. Second resurrection. Jesus put it this way. He said, do not marvel at this, for the hour is coming in which all who are in the graves will hear his voice. Did you notice that? Everybody that is in the graves will hear his voice and come forth, verse 29, those who have done good to the resurrection of life, and those who have done evil to the resurrection of condemnation. So two resurrections that the Bible points out here that Jesus himself confirms. So in which resurrection would you rather go or rather be? The first one, right? Now, if you wake up and you see all kinds of strange people and wanting to hurt somebody, then you know you're in the wrong resurrection, right? All right. We want to be in the first resurrection. The Bible says in verse 3, those who are wise shall shine like the brightness of the what? Firmament. And those who turn many to righteousness like the stars forever and ever. I want to be wise, amen? I want to be wise. And we can be wise with the wisdom of God, amen? And the Bible says those who turn many to righteousness, this is our job, this is our mission, to turn many to righteousness, to Jesus Christ. It says those people are going to shine like the stars forever and ever. Jesus is coming. Whether we believe it or not, whether we accept it or not, Jesus is coming soon. The Bible says in Matthew 24 and verse 30, then the sign of the Son of Man will appear in heaven, and then all the tribes of the earth will mourn. And they will see the Son of Man coming in the clouds of heaven with power and great glory. Amen? So, Jesus is coming. He's coming soon. We see the signs taking place all over the world. The Bible says, for the Son of Man will come in the glory of his Father with his angels. And then he will reward each one according to his what? To his works. Some people think that it doesn't matter what you do. You can live as you please. You can do as you please. And all you have to do is trust in the grace of God. And you don't have to do anything. But according to this verse, he says he's coming to reward each one according to his works. If your works are done in righteousness in Jesus Christ, they count. Amen? We have to be in Jesus Christ in order for that to count. Amen? Well, the Bible says in verse 4, as we look at Daniel chapter 12, verse 4, but you, Daniel, shut up the words and seal the book until the time of the end, this special time. Many shall run to and fro, and knowledge shall increase. Some people think that this verse refers to the fact that we are advancing in all kinds of areas in this world, especially in technology. It used to be that 30 miles an hour was fast. Now, cars are made to go faster and faster. Computers are made to go faster and faster. Phones are made like computers. I mean, it's just amazing. It says, many shall run to and fro, and knowledge shall increase. Not only knowledge in the physical world, but I believe knowledge in the spiritual world, the prophecies of Daniel. Well, in verse 5, here is something that happens. It says, then I, Daniel, looked, and there stood two others, one on this riverbank and the other on that riverbank. And one said to the man clothed in linen who was above the waters of the river, how long shall the fulfillment of these wonders be? Then I heard the man clothed in linen who was above the waters of the river, when he held up his right hand and his left hand to heaven, and swore by him who lives forever and ever, and it shall be for a time, times, and half a time. And when the power of the holy people has been completely shattered, all these things shall be finished. And so we notice that this time prophecy, time, times, and half a time, refers to 1,260 years. And so notice what it says in verse 8. Although I heard, I did not what? Understand. Then I said, my Lord, what shall be the end of these things? You see, don't fret because you don't understand something. Some people say, well, I don't understand it, so I'm just going to leave it alone. Don't give up. Ask God for wisdom, amen? Ask God for help. And so Daniel, he says, he hears, but he doesn't what? He doesn't understand. So it says, what shall be the end of these things? I'm glad that God is there to give us the answer. Verse 9, the Bible says, and he says, go your way, Daniel, for the words are closed up and sealed till the time of the end. So these things are going to be understood in their fullness in this specific time called the time of the end. See, at the time of Daniel, even though he heard these things, he didn't fully understand the full import of the prophecies that he heard. But he says, God says here, they are closed and sealed until the time of the end. Many shall be purified, verse 10, made white and refined, But the wicked shall do wickedly, and none of the wicked shall understand, but the wise shall understand. Now, the only way that you and I can be made pure is not by ourselves or through our efforts. The only way that you and I can be made pure and white is through the blood of Jesus Christ. There is a heavenly detergent, amen, that takes out the stain of sin. It's called the blood of Jesus Christ. And so God says here, many shall be purified. That means that not everybody. There is going to be people who are going to look at Jesus and say, well, I don't want anything to do with him. But the Bible says, the wise shall understand. Now, verse 11. Put on your thinking caps right now. It says, from the time that the daily sacrifice is taken away and the abomination of desolation is set up, there shall be 1,290 days. Some people say, why so many time periods given in the Bible? Because God wants us to understand these things. And so there is one time period mentioned there, 1,290 days. What is that? I want you to look at that phrase, until the desolation is set up. All right? So when we look in the Bible, as we noted times and half a time, that refers to a specific time in history. And that time began in 538, and you count 1,260 years later, you come to the year 1798. So for 1,260 years, this was going to take place. That's that prophecy. What about the 1,290 days? Well, let's put it in perspective. All right? So we have 1,260 years beginning in 538 and ending in 1798. Now, as we noted in verse 11, it says, until the abomination of desolation is set up. In other words, there was going to be a point in time where this was going to be set up, and that will count as the beginning of this 1,290 days. And so that begins in 508 and takes us to 1798. Well, what happened in 508 that was so significant that allowed this power to be set up in 538? Well, there was actually an event that took place in 508, and that was Clovis, the king of the Franks, defeats the Ostrogoths, who were in the way of the papacy from being in power. So he defeated them, and that paved the way for the papacy to be set up as a political power. And so 508 is a very significant date. So as we look at this prophecy again, 538 marks the beginning of the 1,260 years that end up in 1798. And then 508 marks the beginning of the 1,290 years. What happened in 1798 that is so significant? Well, up to this point, the church reigned with full power. And anybody that would challenge the church, what would happen to that person? They would be persecuted, many killed, by the way. And so the church held not only religious power, but also political power. Kings had to go and bow before the Pope for them to be allowed to reign. In 1798, Napoleon came into power, what they call the Renaissance, or the Age of Enlightenment. And he says, we don't need God to tell us what to believe and what to do. We don't need the church. And so he sent his general, Berthier. He went to the Vatican, took the Pope captive in 1798, and the Pope dies in exile. He stripped away the power of the church. Right there is a historical fact. So that marks the end of that period of time. Now, there's another time prophecy that the Bible mentions in verse 12. All right? I don't want to confuse you, but if you're confused, it's fine. Come and ask me afterwards, okay? The Bible says, blessed is he who waits and comes to 1,335 days. So there's several time periods there, 1,290 days, 1,260 days, and 1,335 335 days. It says, blessed, happy is he who waits and comes to the 1,335 days. If the beginning of this prophecy begins in 508, if you count 1,335 years, that takes you to the year 1843. What happened in 1843? Something very significant. There was, in this country and around the world, a movement called the Great Advent Movement. People from all churches and all backgrounds came to believe that Jesus was coming soon. And so many people from different churches came to embrace the second coming of Jesus Christ. They began to study these prophecies in Daniel and Revelation. And they were filled with hope in the second coming of Jesus Christ. So the Bible says, blessed is he who comes to the end of the 1,335 years. Because they were going to hear with their own ears about Jesus' coming. Many people confessed their sins. Many people turned to God. Many people gave their lives to God in that time. It was a great movement that began here and is spread all around the world. The Bible says in Daniel 8 and verse 13, then I heard a holy one speaking and another holy one to that certain one who was speaking. How long will the vision be concerning the daily sacrifices and the transgression of desolation? The giving of both the sanctuary and the host to be trampled underfoot. How long is this going to take? Well, when the Bible asks a question, he gives the answer. He said, and he said to me, for 1,300 days, then shall the sanctuary be cleansed. 2,300 days come to 1844. And that, my friends, is the beginning of Jesus' priestly ministry in the heavenly sanctuary. He goes from the holy place to the most holy place. The thing to understand about the cleansing of the sanctuary is an Old Testament symbol of the final work of judgment prior to Christ's second coming. What that means is this, that right now in heaven, Jesus is interceding for us. What that means is that we have help available to us, amen? What that means is that you can come to Jesus Christ and ask him for help, and he is right there, amen? The Bible says, this is how it ends, in verse 13 of Daniel 12, but you go your way till the end. God wants us to be faithful until the end. Amen? God wants us to start the race with him and continue to run with him until the end. Some people get discouraged. Some people give up. Some people say, well, this is too hard. It's not for me. You know, this is for the birds. Or, you know, I'm too young to be involved in church things. God wants us to be faithful until the end. Amen? Go your way till the end, for you shall rest and will arise to your inheritance at the end of days. See, there is a bright future for those who serve God. Yes, you may die. Yes, you may pass away. But Jesus is coming soon. And when he does, you will arise to your what? Inheritance. God has an inheritance for us. Amen? He wants us to understand that Jesus Christ is coming soon. Very soon, the sky will split open. Amen? Very soon, we are going to see Jesus coming in the clouds of heaven. And he's coming, the Bible says, with all his angels. And he wants us to be ready for his coming. Amen? Time is almost up. All you have to do is look at what the Bible says and compare to what is happening today in the world. And you will know that, in fact, Jesus is coming soon. He wants us to be ready. Amen? And so, as we finish the book of Daniel today, I want to make a commitment to God that I want to walk with him. I want to serve him until the end. Jesus invites us to take hold of his hand and say, God, I too want to rise up with you when Jesus comes. I want to be ready. I want to give my life to him. And so today, as we close, I invite you to bow your heads Close your eyes. Father in heaven, once again, we are grateful. Grateful to you for your word. Grateful to you because you bring light into our world. You bring light into our life. Today, Father, we have understood that there is going to be a time of trouble, such as never was since there was a nation on this planet. But God, you come with a rescue plan. A rescue plan that was formulated a long time ago. And this plan involved the death of Jesus Christ, our all-sufficient Savior. And so, Father, today, we give our lives to you. We turn the controls over to you. Help us, Lord. Bless us as we continue. In Jesus' mighty name, amen and amen. This time, what we'd like to do we want to welcome our new members, and so I'd like to invite Beth Wright to come up. And also Rodney. This is for you. God bless you. This is for you, Rodney. And we have a little gift from the church. This is Beth. All right. Turn this way so they can see you. And Rodney. Let's give them an amen.
Amen.
Amen. Praise God. Yeah. Okay. All right. God bless you. This time I'm going to ask Brother James to come up, and we are going to do the presentation of the certificates.
Here, come on up. If you're not, don't worry about it, obviously. Elna Anderson.
Elena Anderson? You here? Okay.
Maud Anderson. Dwayne Acock. Phil Acock. Sonia Barley. Christine Barrett. Jeanette Bick, Chris Blythe, Alberta Donqua, Hank Branch,
God bless you. Okay? All right.
Partilla Branch.
Partilla Branch? Okay.
Partilla Branch. Did I say it wrong? Partilla Branch. Okay.
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 God bless you. Okay? All right.
Andrea Butler. Roger Butler, Dervant Clark.
Dervant Clark.
Well, I know I saw him here.
Yeah.
Okay.
Hey. God bless you. Okay? All right.
Ellen Clark. Ellen Crummett. Helen Crummett. Paul Crummett. Christina Sanka. Catherine DeAra. Rodney Davis. Right. David Ferguson. Cliff Funk. Alan Green. Janine Green. Wilma Jeffers. Teresa Jennings.
Teresa? She's right there. And Tom.
Tom Jennings.
Come on down. The blessing is right. Yeah. Okay, Teresa, God bless you. Okay. Yeah, you made it.
I made it.
All right.
Tracy Keenan.
Tracy's right there.
Did I get that name right? Okay.
Tracy. Tracy. Mm-hmm. God bless you. Okay.
Sue Legenzoff. Matthew Manuel. Saifo Mambo. Fernando Montoya. Larry Moore. David Munoz. Enrique Munoz. Kevin Ortiz. Joanna Osim. Giorgio Perez. Maelia Perez. Pamela Parr. Rose Penenda. Kate Powers.
All right, Kate. Bless you. Okay.
Barbie Rauch. And Paul Rauch.
God bless you.
Brian Reeves and Todd Reeves.
God bless you. Okay. It's for your brother.
Jana Ridley.
All right.
Troy Ridley.
Troy is not here.
Okay.
All right. Your mom? Do you have Natasha? Natasha Ridley? We'll get it. Thanks.
Gula Sader. Erica Sadler.
Eula?
Eula Sadler.
Okay, she's right there. The lady with a nice hat. All right.
Pei Saw. Okay. Cornelia Scott. Okay.
Bless you. Thanks.
Patrick Squales. Cynthia Thomas. Rosalind Taiswa. Antonio Usado. Betty and David Wheeler. Okay, for those we have left over, we'll mail them out to the folks who cannot make it today.
All right. So this time, we would like to give special thanks to those who helped in the seminar in different ways. You know, this was a big undertaking for the church, and we could not have done it without God's help, number one, and then number two, without your help, your volunteers. And so we have several gifts I would like to give. And want to come up? Thank you. So we're just going to call names here. Wanda Jones, is she here? Wanda? Okay, just put her to the side. Okay, Jason Maloney. Jason, not here. Bajor Johnson. Bajor. Yeah. All right. Praise the Lord. We have Jane Trichler. Andrew Wright. While Andrew's coming, I'll call another name here. Maribel Santiago. God bless you. Okay. All right, we have Violet. Violet, she here? She's not here. Portia Prudencio. Giovanna Wright. Bless you. That's her husband, by the way. Heidi Candia, the photographer.
Selfie.
God
Selfie.
Bless you. Deborah. Deborah, is she here? She was here? Okay. All right. Go on here. Alice. Alice, where are you? Alice?
There you go.
There you go. Praise the Lord. Steve Stewart. God bless you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Purcell. Brother Purcell. Where are you at? God bless you. Another Purcell, right there. Thank you, brother. Erica Norman. Bill Jones. I don't know if Bill is here. Daniel Vasquez. While he's coming up, call another name. Jackie LaMarca. Is she here? Okay. Valerie Stewart. Okay. We have Chloe Garvey. I don't know if Chloe is here. Chloe Garvey. Okay. Thank you. Well, she's coming. Call another name here. Lisbeth Hernandez. This is Chloe. Thank you. God bless you. Lisbeth Hernandez. Okay. Amber. Amber Haig. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Bill Hagerman. Don't look at the weight of the bag, just look at what's inside. Margie Santiago. Thank you. Thank you very much. All right, we have John McPherson. All right. Diana Santiago. We're almost there. Anytime. Suzette Charles. While she's coming, Mary and Robert Littlejohn. Okay. Thank you. God bless you. We also have Lorna Wright. Thank you. God bless you.
She didn't want to come up.
Lorna Wright, are you here? She's at the kitchen. Well, her husband or somebody come up. All right, Lisa McPherson. Thank you. Okay. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Ana Munoz. I don't think she's here. Okay. Let's put it aside. Elena and Larry. Elena and Larry. Not here. Okay. Ben Santiago. Doug Hegg. Doug. Okay, one more here. Wilma Jeffers. She's not here. Okay. Karen Garvey. She here? Velna Wright. Thank you very much for your help. This is Velna. Okay. And while she's coming, we have Janet Armstrong. Thank you. Thank you. Muchas gracias. All right. Almost there, I promise. Sandra Tensley, she's not here. All right. Esther Opoku. Oh, this is for Sandra. Make sure you're good. Yeah. Thank you. Thank you, thank you. Okay. Diane and Ken Grimes. Diane and Ken, they're over there, or they're outside, I don't know. All right. There is one more. Ginseel Maloney is not here. I'd like to have, thank you. Brother James Johnson, come up. So, Brother James, he is my right-hand man. He was the coordinator for the meetings, bringing all the ministries together to help. And so, just a humble thing that we'd like to give you.
Thank you, sir.
Okay? God bless you.
Thank you. God bless you.
And last but not least, okay, so we have a... We have a lady that is very dear to my heart, and anyhow,
it better be me.
Yes, dear.
I'm like.
Notice I said yes, dear. You know that's a good thing to say. Amen. So. Sonia, on behalf of the church, we want to give you this, okay? And I'm going to hug you. Okay. God bless you. Okay.
Thank you.
You have to go up there again. You have to. So. Some of you may or may not know that today is actually her birthday. Okay. So, okay. Happy birthday.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay. I think that's it. Okay, so that's all the special thanks. Now, there are some of you who also helped in different ways. We don't want to overlook you, but thank you for making this a success. And this is how we measure success. It's not the amount of baptisms that we have in our church. It is the spirit in which we do things. And we do it for God. And we do it for Him. We have several people that have benefited from this seminar. Many people in the community who came out. And many people who are here. And we praise God for that. So please continue to work. Please continue to pray for all these individuals. And so I just want to thank God for all of you. And we want to plan another one. Maybe not next month, but another one in the future. All right? And maybe we'll focus now on the book of Revelation. And so thank you. Thank you once again. We will now continue with our program. And we are going to do the closing song and then have the benediction.
Wow. We invite you to stand and join us in singing our closing hymn, 330, take my life and let it be consecrated, Lord, to Thee.
Before we pray, I'd like to remind you that we have a fellowship meal in the gym, and after my prayer, then I'll be followed by the newly baptized members, and you will all give them a big welcome to our church. Let's bow our heads. Father in heaven, once again, we are grateful to you for your blessings. Thank you, Lord, for allowing us to come and to witness this special day for two souls, Lord, that have been born now into your kingdom. We pray your blessing upon them, Lord. We pray that you may continue to guide them. Continue to bless everyone here, those who are watching via the internet, and help us, Lord, to work for you. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. The deacons will dismiss you.